All right, my name is Mike Black, and it's probably the first, this is definitely the first podcast that we've recorded, me and my homies, but I'm pretty much just a regular nigga. We're just trying to bullshit, have some good times, you know, figure some shit out, fucking talk about pretty much anything, you know, just be completely open. And pretty much where I'm coming from is why I pretty much wanted to do this is just to kind of get myself out there, fucking break some barriers, fucking, and maybe there's some shit I can say that will help somebody, you know. Maybe there's some deeper levels to my life that I didn't even know. Like, maybe I can discover something about myself through this. Who knows? Like, there's a lot of things that could happen, but that's basically where I'm coming from, and I just wanted to get myself out there. Maybe take that leap of faith.
What's up, everybody? My name's Jerrick Naylor. I guess I'm doing this kind of similar to Mike. I guess even as I was listening to him explain it, it kind of struck some chords for me as to why I'm even wanting to do this, why I'm driven to do it. I guess it's an idea I've had for a while, and now is the time where I'm attempting to take that leap of faith. And it's definitely going to be a challenge for me because I have always had a hard time communicating with people in my life. And that comes out in so many different ways. And then there's times where I'm just so, I can communicate with someone so perfectly that I feel like the information that gets shared is so valuable. And I've listened to other people on podcasts just sharing themselves, and it gives me so much, I don't like calling it information, I guess that seems too technical, but it gives me so much inspiration. That's probably a better term to use. Inspiration from my own life. And I guess it's one of those things that you have to let your barriers down and realize that there's other smart people out there that have things to say, and even people that you wouldn't perceive as smart when you first see them, they have something, a new perspective to share. And I that's what's so interesting about podcasting to me, is that you really, it's not like limited by anything. Anyone can just get on and just be themselves, and how, you know, that just, if you want to listen to it, you can, and if not, go to the next podcast until you find someone you like. Like, there's so many people out there. I guess that's why I'm interested in it.
All right, my name is Alex Black. These guys have hit a lot of points that I was gonna make, but for me, podcasting, it's always been something to open my mind with someone else's mind, and kind of take and pick and choose what I kind of want to investigate or want to go further in my mind into. And so it's always nice to just listen and hear other people's perspective, and it's gonna be great to try and give out mine as well, because it's great sharing my perspective with people. I feel like when we do get into perspective, different conversations, that, you know, things are always great when you're having more than one perspective in the circle. And so I do that with listening and being part of podcasts, and as well as when I'm talking with other people. And so I'm glad to give out that as well. And so, yeah.
We are recording, bitches. We are live on this motherfucking podcast.
Live on this motherfucker.
What do we got to say to the world? This is our time to shine. Like, all those shower thoughts, dude. All the fucking thoughts while you're taking a hot steamy shower, where you're like, God damn, I was listening to that. Because I just went off on something. Now's the time to let it all out on the table.
How's the holidays?
The holidays were pretty good. They were pretty good. I guess it's just not like when you're a kid.
Definitely not.
It's not like when you're a little kid. It's just like... Like, when you're a little kid, like, December comes, and then it's immediately, like, oh, mm-hmm. Christmas, dude. Like, Christmas is coming up.
And New Year.
But then when you're an adult, it's like, all right, December hits. You, like, kind of start thinking about Christmas. Next thing you know, it's the 20th. And it's like, oh, my God, Christmas is in 5 days. Like, I haven't even thought about this. I haven't got excited for it. But fucking, here it is.
Yeah, I don't know. It's been a weird Christmas season. It's definitely not like it used to be when I was a kid, at least.
Yeah.
Yeah, I feel like the holidays are kind of a weird thing. I feel like a lot of the values of the holidays should be taken and spread around through the whole year. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I agree. Yeah, like Thanksgiving especially.
Yeah.
Like, it's actually kind of strange. I was thinking about this a lot on Thanksgiving, how Black Friday is the day after, which is, if you think about it, like the exact opposite of being thankful.
Yeah.
You're being thankful is appreciating what you have. Black Friday is, oh my God, look what I can get. Like, look at all the opportunity for me to get. It's like the ultimate distraction from the one time where you're supposed to be thankful in the year.
Yeah. You know, that's kind of funny.
Boom, Black Friday to distract
you. I definitely never thought about that.
Yeah, I was thinking about it. I guess I never really came to a conclusion about it. I was like, it was just a thought. I was like, is that good, bad? Like, I don't know. It just happens to be that way, I guess.
Yeah. 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 Actually, I was listening to this one podcast with somebody. God damn it, I can't remember, but they were actually fasting on Thanksgiving instead of actually eating a fuckload on Thanksgiving to actually be thankful for the food that you actually get every day, you know, because it's kind of weird how we give thanks by just eating, just gluttony and just like getting all freaky with it. But I do it. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
fuck. I shouldn't be talking shit, but yeah, it is what it is.
But you think about it, every Thanksgiving, that party that I've ever been to, there's always been a leftovers, you know?
Yeah.
And so, I could see fasting, but I could also see, you know, making the right proportions for knowing who's going to be there. You know?
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
And so just going ham.
Something, yeah.
It's kind of a challenge, especially if you can make those really dank brownies, and you're like, how much do I need to make for Thanksgiving? And you're like, all right, I'm gonna try to conserve, and then you make like 2 pans, and they're gone in like 5 minutes. You're like,
yeah,
I should have made 5 pans.
Because there's that nigga that's gonna eat 4 brownies, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
That's that guy that's gonna need 4 brownies.
Yeah.
But yeah, the holidays are a weird thing. Christmas weirds me out. Christmas weirds me out. I don't know, all of them kind of do. They're kind of an odd thing. You just kind of, like, all these set in stone kind of rules, you know?
Yeah.
Like, these traditions that we're still following after so long. I don't know, it's kind of fascinating.
Yeah, and it's I can see a beneficial side to it.
Yeah.
Like, it following the traditions, and it's all exciting and everything. But I can also kind of see, like, a weird side to it where it's, like, expected. You know, like, it's part of, like, you are almost expected to be able to pay for gifts. And if you can't provide your children with gifts or something, then there's this guilt that's, like, almost, like, associated with it. Like, what if you're just, like, having a hard time, like, at that certain point in time of year, and you can't keep up with these holiday expectations, I guess.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's, I don't know, it's not horrible, but
yeah.
I can kind of see a positive and a negative to it.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. But if those, like, I don't know, like, certain festivals like Burning Man and, like, stuff like that, you know, that gifting and, like, stuff like that is just kind of always going on, you know. Everybody's mm-hmm. always kind of helping each other out. Everybody's always kind of just contributing and just doing what they can, you know. Like, yeah. on Christmas, everybody's helping out the homeless shelters. And on Thanksgiving, everybody's doing the same thing, you know. Yeah. They're giving out, like, clothes and stuff like that. But, like, why not just be that nice all the time, you know? Why yeah. not? Why not? Or, you know, when, like, there's just so many values that are, like, centered around those days that people only show around those days, you know?
Yeah, that's true. And I guess I'm not really sure why that is, because we do like to give, you know,
uh-huh.
we like that, but we also, it's a chore, I guess, and around the holidays, would you say it's just more popular? It's just a popular thing to do, to be giving, or is that just like the one time a year that people happen to think about it?
Yeah, I guess it's kind of just like a reminder, I guess. I don't know. It's just like, and I don't even think it's a lot of, it's kind of getting too, you know, like.
Yeah.
It's just a weird time, I feel like. It's been a weird time since childhood, I don't know. I got kind of a bitter past with it.
Oh.
That's probably why. But I don't know. It is what it is, but I feel like a lot of those values should be just spread a lot thinner through the rest of the year.
Yeah. I agree with that. But not that I'm saying that I definitely don't help out at charities very often. Or,
yeah.
You know, I definitely try to do my part and
yeah.
help out around the house and just do kind of random acts of kindness. But, yeah, I don't know. I definitely am not the most giving guy around all the time, but I could say that people should be that way. I can agree with you there.
Yeah. Maybe we'll need to be that change, dog. Maybe we
can be that. You got a good point.
Maybe we can be that change.
Yeah.
Maybe we can, you know, there's always time.
Yeah.
Another crazy thing to think about, though, is after Halloween, the next, four, five holidays for the next 5 months are all kind of giving. You know, Thanksgiving, Christmas, kind of New Year's, kind of Valentine's Day,
mm-hmm.
St. Patrick's Day, you know, people. And then the kind of summer months, they're kind of weirder holidays. And so, like, 4th of July, I guess you go out with people, but they're more like you going out, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And then, like, giving something. You're just going out to see fireworks, you know? Stuff like that during the summer. So during the summer, you're more focused on you know?
Because
mm-hmm. you're out there in the sun and all that. And then during the winter, when it gets a little bit more cold and you want to be a little bit more in your house more, you have the holidays that make you kind of get out, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And share that spirit with your families, you know? For those couple months while it gets a little cold, while you're not out doing your thing. So
that's kind of interesting. So it's like a cycle, kind of like
yeah.
going from focused on yourself and I guess improving yourself in a way, and then focus, and especially as you say, as it gets cold, because that kind of makes sense, because you're like, oh, the world's like difficult again, like I need people's help again to get me through this. So you're like, all right, I'll go back to giving for that portion. That, yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah, that's fascinating. I was just thinking about how, like, the holidays make me need to, like, almost branch out for help, almost, like, I don't know, because I feel like it's a rough time for a lot of people, you know, like, there's just a lot of, like, maybe things happen in waves, you know, but I feel like a lot of stuff happens around this time of year, like, just a lot of, I don't know, a lot of people just died just barely, you know, like, a lot of, like, there's just a lot of, there's a lot of momentum to really push to be, like, your highest self, I guess, through all the fucking shit that's going on, you know, because I don't know, shit can get rough, but, like, I don't know, everything will be okay no matter what, you know? No matter how rough it gets, I feel like, you know?
Yeah.
Like, yeah. Shit will, no matter what, be okay somehow. At least that's something that's been in the back of my head for, like, my whole life. Mm-hmm. I don't know why, but it's just one thing that's, like, been there, you know? I feel like I've always figured it out, you know?
Yeah. It always, the puzzle pieces always eventually come together.
Yeah.
In a way. And that's definitely a feeling that I've had for a long time. And something that I've really kind of dived into a little bit, just the fact that everything is going to be okay. And even when you're talking about, like, really bad situations, like, the way we perceive them has so much to do with the way that we feel about them. You know, the thoughts we have about them basically create the experience, in a sense. So, lost track of where I was going.
The thoughts we have basically create your experience.
Oh, yeah. So, basically, if you can, like, see through the thoughts, in a sense, then it is okay. Like, it really, like, in reality, before we've applied any sort of meaning to it, which is basically what we are, we're meaning-creating machines, and that's what we operate on, like, reality itself is okay. Like, it's nothing but okay.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's, you know, I kind of, I guess I didn't have that feeling when I was younger. The fact that, the feeling that everything was going to be okay. I didn't have that when I was younger. I feel like that was something that I kind of had to realize that the way we perceive reality is not what reality is. You know, it's just the way we perceive it because we're human, because we're built this way. It's our ego, you know, it's our entire... It's everything for us. It's all the way. It's all the meaning we attach to everything, I guess. And recently, I've kind of discovered the fact that everything's going to be okay, and it's such a beautiful thing. It's so beautiful to realize. Well, and I guess for some people it could be hard to see because the afterlife is so. So up in the air. There's nobody knows.
There's no guarantee.
Yeah.
Everybody's looking for that guaranteed solution. That's why religion is, you know.
Yeah.
Because that guaranteed solution, you know.
But with religion, there's... And see, I don't know if they would... Like, some religions believe in hell, some religions don't believe in hell. But the ones that do believe in hell, I find it... At least for me, it would be... very difficult to see reality the way that I do, because for me it's like even the most horrible things, the most horrible conceivable things, are only horrible because I happen to be human and I perceive them that way. You know, it's not like in reality they're actually horrible.
Yeah.
You know, so the concept of hell basically proves that things are actually horrible. And if you participate in them, then you are horrible, you know? But I guess I see it as impossible for someone to be horrible.
Yeah.
And I guess this is kind of where it comes in with the free will.
Two sides of the coin.
Yeah,
there's just two sides of the coin. There has to be one to be the other, you know? You have to respect either side because they're both... essentially part of the same thing, you know. They both come down to the same root, and they're both, I don't know, there's no sides, no nothing, you know. Mm-hmm. Like, it's just, you know, just we're all fucking one thing or whatever, but I don't know, it's kind of insane to think about that there's really no, like, when it comes down to it, there's no bad or good. Like, it's just what is, you know. Mm-hmm. Everything's just what is, until you come along and judge it, you know, mm-hmm. until you, like, even, like, it's weird to think about. I don't know.
Yeah, and I agree, it's weird, but, you know, I guess on the other side, and this is something that we have all definitely talked about, is we are human right now.
Yeah.
Living the dualistic the point of view, you know, the everything has an equal and an opposite, an opposite, and that's what we are in right now. So in a sense, you could argue that that is just as true.
Yeah.
Just as true as the truth that in reality everything's not good, not bad. It's all neutral. I hesitate to even say neutral because I don't want to say, like, it is good. It is good. Its natural state is good.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not in the negative. Like, just reality itself is all good. But, yeah. You know, but then there's our human side of it, which we have good and bad. We have potential to live up to, I guess. And when we don't live up to that potential, when we don't choose free will, when we let the universe make decisions for us, in a sense, then that is kind of bad. That is kind of actually bad, you know, no matter what way you look at it.
Well, it's just kind of pausing something, I feel like. Maybe pausing some greater momentum, you know, that's pushing all things forward, you know, because I don't know, I found myself in loops before. I found myself caught up in things before where I felt like I've been doing the same thing over and over again. Like, I don't know, there's similar things now, you know? You go to the same job over and over again. I'm just like, there's gotta be a... I don't know, the main thing is I'm trying not to repeat my history, you know, at this point. I'm trying to really focus on what I've done and what the mistakes I've made, and I'm trying not to go back over them because I think I've learned from them, and all the mistakes maybe I haven't learned from all the way, I'll make again, and I'll fucking learn from them again, even more, to where I'll stop fucking making that mistake, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And maybe that's my whole existence, you know? Maybe I'll fucking stop making this stop. Like, maybe I'll beat the game, you know? Maybe I'll beat this whole fucking thing and just look at it from a whole new way, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe I'll just wake up from a fucking trip one day, you know? And just be like, oh my God. I learned a lot, you know, because you get the trip you want, not the trip you need. I fucking forgot who said that, but
see, and I guess that whole thing, I guess it does kind of raise a couple questions, because the whole concept of learning is
I switched the words
around is that, by the way. No, I mean, like, just the whole concept of learning is just, it's like a human thing. You know, like, it's a human ability we have. It's basically taking information, putting it into our brains, and storing it as data. I mean, I have no idea how our brain does that. Some sort of electrical thing, probably some sort of physical thing also that it creates memories with. And would you assume that our ability to learn extends past our human existence? Because if it doesn't, then technically learning lessons isn't, like, that important, I guess. Except for to improve our current life.
Well, you know what I mean? Well, maybe we, in our existence, is constant. We're just gathering information for something greater, for some big old fucking information bank, wherever, whatever it is, you know,
mm-hmm.
whatever you want to call it, God, infinite, anything. But we're just collecting information. We're just gaining perspective, just gaining, doing, and just finding the purpose to our lives, just to gain that greater perspective for that fucking big old cloud of consciousness.
Collective consciousness.
Collective consciousness. Just that, that fucking whatever you want to call it. And, yeah, maybe once we die or whatever, we'll just realize, okay, this is what's really up, you know? This oneness, this God, this collective consciousness, and I don't know, maybe it's just some big cycle, you know? Like rain in a cloud, you know? Like we're just getting constantly rained down into fucking little droplets, you know? And turned into something, incarnated into something, or and then die off, evaporate, you know, and just constantly going from there. Maybe after we learn from that cycle, you know, after we are done with it, after we've gained that perspective to its fullest, maybe we will transcend some other point, you know? Who knows? Break, I don't know.
The cycle,
kind yeah, of. Yeah, break the cycle.
Or
you know?
Maybe the cycle is just
Or maybe the it, cycle is like, just another... Well, yeah, the cycle could just be it. Like, this, it definitely could be. And maybe it isn't a cycle. There's just... Like...
Yeah.
There's just so much...
I feel like it can't be as simple as something as we could be able to explain right now. Like, it couldn't be that simple. It has to be something more complex than we can, like, fully understand right now. But I feel like you can explain it a bunch of different ways and kind of tie all those together and... Yeah, see, I don't want to say you can get an understanding of what
you can.
You think
gain a greater perspective.
Yeah, almost. I guess more possibilities is what it comes down to. Because ultimately, you can't figure it out until you directly experience it. Just like with anything in life, you can try and imagine it in a million different ways, and then as soon as you experience it, it's never quite like you'd imagine because you don't. I mean, especially when we're talking about things like the afterlife, because we have limited ways to experience now. Like, what if the entire way we experience is just totally not even the same? Like, no sight, no sound, touch, any of that. Like, all that is how we experience now. Like, it could be totally something different. And trying to comprehend an existence where you experience things in a different way, with different senses... That's where it's just infinite possibilities, yeah. I guess.
And maybe our sight, touch, and eyesight, and this whole body is just blocking us from any raw, true experience, mm-hmm. You know? Maybe, well, I don't know, I feel like all this experience is true right now, but, like, for the raw truth to what... Everything is. I don't know.
I think I kind of see what you're saying, because everything we experience is through like neurotransmitters, basically.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so
it's filtered.
Yeah, it's like. Yeah, it's filtered. That's what our brain is. It's just one giant filter. It filters out this infinite amount of information coming at us from all different points, and probably even information that we don't even know is there right now. Like, there's sound and there's radio waves. We can't pick up on those. What else type of information is out there that our brain is filtering out right now because we don't even know it's there, you know? And it basically just filters everything down and finds what's useful. And what's useful to us happens to be sound, which is just vibrations in the air. Light, which is... I don't even know what light is. It's a wave. It's a particle. It's... has mass to it. Light's hard to comprehend. Sound's a little easier, I guess. And then touch, which is just electricity, I guess, would you say? Because you touch something and you feel the force of it pushing back on your nerves, which is ultimately what translates it.
But then on top of that, whether it's soft, hard, hot, or cold, it all depends on what your thoughts are on it.
Oh, so your thoughts kind of complement. Because
somebody could
the
say
experience.
It's cold if they, you know, felt mm-hmm. things hotter than that. When somebody else that's never felt something a quarter of that hot touches it, and it is extremely hot. And so, just like when you eat hot sauce, mm-hmm. somebody that eats a lot of hot sauce can eat really hot sauce. Somebody that doesn't takes a little tiny bite of mild sauce and is freaking out.
Yeah.
And so, but on that thought, I do believe that there is more than just your body, than your mind and your thoughts, that you do have a soul. And I do believe that that kind of goes back to kind of like a, like you guys were saying, like a bank of just conscious information mm-hmm. altogether. And so that little bank has put a little deposit into this human body so we can experience this in all the ways that we use our sensual organs, our senses, and perceive them in our brain. Because it, each of us has different thoughts about every single thing, every single, you know. The way I think about it is if you had twins in a house, you know, they would grow up thinking, you know, close, because they'd have the same, almost the same experience, but they still would be a little bit off each, because they're each a different part of that thing that is a part of what their parents made them into. And so,
another way of looking at things.
So you would say, not instead of just like not being able to directly experience things just because we have to experience them through our senses, but also that thoughts kind of get in the way of us being able to experience like the rawness of it, is because our thoughts are always layered on top of our experience, in a sense. You know, like we experience through our senses, and then our thoughts come in and give us like a perspective, like a commentary almost on our experience, which would be the hot or the cold, and the comparisons, basically comparisons to other things in your life, like how you said someone could say it's hot and someone say it's cold based on, you know, other experiences in their life.
Just like somebody with a dollar in India is a lot, a dollar in India is a lot more money than a dollar is here, you know, like
the three of them, mind, body, spirit, they're all together in us and everything. It's you know, your mind makes the thoughts, your body gives you the senses, and your spirit is the thing that connects everything. And so
the spirit's where the free will,
where the will is, exactly, the spirit, your will,
where
you are,
flows through you, where,
but yeah,
oh, it's the thing experiencing,
it's the thing experiencing the thoughts and the body and the senses.
Oh, I see what you're
the spirit saying. but then we don't know, but I believe that is eternal, you know. And that's just part of this everything, that it just inhabits each part of everything, so it can feel every part of everything.
Yeah, and that's probably why you feel sympathy for people, you know. That's probably why when you see a homeless person on the street, you kind of are like, damn, you know, like, at least if you're thinking about it, you're like, damn, what would it be like, you know, to be in those shoes, you know, at least if you've... And I know everybody's thought of it, you know, just, I feel that's probably just another way of connecting with that fucking cloud of consciousness, you know, because, like, we're all just watching this, well, experiencing this fucking life, you know, we're all just experiencing it, and some of us have different experiences, but it's experiencing it. And that's one thing we all have in common.
That's the one thing we all have in common. And when I refer to oneness, that's exactly what I mean. The ability to experience. That's what makes us all the same. Is we all are the ability to experience. But then, you know, that branches off into all of our differences. But that's where we're one. I feel like that's where it all connects to one. That's the one thing that just relates all of us. You know.
yeah, definitely. I feel you there. That's kind of where the point that I've come to for now. And yeah, I don't know. I feel like if you, like, no matter what you're doing, if you come from it from that altruistic perspective, from just seeing everything as one, and just trying to, instead of doing things for yourself, you know, well, even do things for yourself to improve that fucking whole greater fucking thing, you know? Yeah. Do things for yourself to improve that greater cloud of consciousness.
So it's like kind of like a melding of the egotistical point of view and the group point of view.
Yeah, well, it's like they both benefit each other. You can't do anything for anybody if you haven't done what you need to do for yourself.
Yeah. It's funny, I was actually thinking that same thing yesterday, just like one of those random thoughts that pop in your mind. Like, you can't help the world if you haven't helped yourself, because you're not prepared to do that yet.
Yeah.
You know, it's almost like a competition out there. Like, there's so many incredible people out there that you, in order to, and I don't want to say compete, because like what you really want to do is help the world in a meaningful way. Like, that's where you're going to find your purpose in life. And there's a lot of other people trying to do that same thing. And so it almost is like a competition. It's like you have to earn the right to be able to help the world in a meaningful way. Like, in that sort of sense. Because obviously you could go help the world in a meaningful way by going and doing charity and stuff. And,
yeah.
And, you know, helping out the homeless. You could give, you know, you could do one tiny little act that helps the world in a meaningful way. But if you want to have the type of impact that I feel like we as humans crave, like, we all crave this, like, just impact on the world in a large scale way. Well, I don't know about we all, but from my personal experience and from what I experience from other people, everybody wants to have a big impact on the world.
Yeah.
And you have to help, you have to, I don't want to say perfect yourself, but you have to get close. You have to improve on yourself so much that you can earn the right to help the world.
Or maybe you just have to be comfortable with yourself, in a sense. Like, maybe you just have to know yourself well enough to where you're comfortable trying to do something greater for the world, you know? Mm-hmm. To where you're like, all right, I have no doubts to even worry about, you know? To even trip myself up about, because I can do this. I can do whatever I want, you know? Because that's the weird thing that has been tripping my mind up, even, because it's weird to even think about that I can actually do whatever the fuck I want, like, anything in the world I can do. But it's, for some reason, there's some barriers there, and I know it's barriers that I put up, but it's something crazy to even think about, that you can do whatever the fuck you want in this world.
Because it doesn't always feel like that. A lot of the times it feels like there's, like, almost the path you're kind of just following every day, you know, because, like, you're just going to work every day, and it's like, it's almost like you have to. It's almost like that's just the way to do it, but you technically can do anything you want. But I was going to say something about something else you said, but... Oh, so would you say that... So you said it's kind of becoming comfortable with yourself. So would you say that it's not necessarily like a self-mastery that's required, but just like a self-acceptance?
Yes.
That is kind of required in order for you to... Because, I mean, how do you help the world in an impactful way? You express yourself in the truest way, basically.
Exactly.
Whether that's through music or through podcasts or whatever your thing is, dance even, like, whatever inspires people, that's how you're going to have an impact on the world, is just by being your truest self, which also includes selflessness, which is, I mean, I don't know, maybe some people don't. Maybe their true self is not selfless, but from my personal experience, selflessness is tied into happiness. Like, it's one of the factors of happiness. You have to be selfless every once in a while, at least.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I feel like it's the whole karma thing, you know. You you get what you give, you know, like, and, like, you don't have to give things in fucking material form, you know, and gifts, you know. You could just be nice to somebody, give somebody a compliment, you know, fucking anything, you know. Just help somebody out, you know. Anything. Telling them that they got it, you know. Well, there's a lot of things that you can do. But I don't know, there's a lot more to just helping people out than I think, like... I think there's something, I don't know, there's just such a great feeling that comes from it. I don't know. It's mm-hmm. almost like you almost get selfish for a minute thinking, "Oh my, like, oh, I fucking gave something away, you yeah. know? Like I'm a fucking charity giver, you yeah. know? Like you almost are like, "Oh, I'm such a great person." But you know, like, if that's how you do it, then you still, like, it's still getting done, but, I don't know, there's a lot of ways to look at it, but, it's pretty insane. Yeah.
And even if you're just doing your art, you know, that's how you, maybe that's how you help people. Exactly. You're not even, because in a sense, it's almost selfish to just focus on your art, but that in and of itself could help people in incredible ways that I guess would be hard to even imagine as you're making the art. But also, now that I think about it, your art probably would have to contain some level of selflessness in it in order to be, like, appealing to people. Yes, because people are attracted to that, because if your art, like, emanates ego and self-centeredness, then people get the vibe, well, it's like, well, it's all about them. Like, why would I care about if it's all about you? Like, I want to know when it's about everyone, when it involves me and when it involves everything, you know? Like, why would I even care if it's all about you?
Yeah, well, remember, it has nothing to do with me. Remember those Alex Gray paintings that we were looking at earlier? Mm-hmm. They represent something so much deeper, you know. I feel like he's trying to get such a... Alex Gray, if you don't know him, you should look him up, but he's trying to get a message across with his art. And I feel like all meaningful art these days is trying to get some sort of message across, because, I don't know, we only have so much longer here on this planet, you know. We're kind of fucking things up, you know. I feel like a lot of art tries to get that across. Mm-hmm. And I feel like a lot of music tries to get that across. And I feel like there's just a lot of points to get across with art, just subtly, you know, like...
Yeah. Ooh, I need to do this. and honestly, even just, like, the small day-to-day things that everyone goes through, I feel like a lot of art and a lot of music... just relates to those small things in life, you know, that, like, everyone can relate to, like, especially country songs. they're so sentimental, and they're always, you know, about the cold beer and the blue jeans and the red pickup truck and just the things that everyone can relate to every day to day. And I guess in a way that's a message, you know, that's a message.
Well, and I guess you could also say that when your work isn't like your dream job, you know how everybody wants to say that you should work where you want so mm-hmm. that you love it.
Yeah.
When the majority of the time isn't what you want it to be, well, instead of when you're just wasting time at home by yourself, you could be doing something that you love, you know, mm-hmm. so that... That could also bring you a little bit more happiness in your life, you know, because you're doing something that you love outside of work.
Yeah.
And then on top of that, it could, you know, be that kind of selflessness, because you feel like, you know, when you go to work, it sucks, but it's, like, kind of selfish because you have to go to work for you mm-hmm. to live. And so when you're doing the stuff that you love outside of work, then it's more kind of like, you know, you're being selfless because you're helping yourself out. And usually when you do stuff that you like outside of work, you know, you'll have friends or something that will like it or that do the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
that will appreciate it. And so,
yeah, almost like a little, like a community of people that you've built around yourself.
Kind of how everyone says, like, you know, hang around 4 millionaires, you'll be the fifth, you know?
Yeah.
Hang around, you know, the people you hang around are you, you know?
Yeah.
That kind of sense of thinking is what I kind of feel like it come, it is a little part of it, of everything.
See, I feel like I can relate to that whole, just doing what you want outside of work, at home, like, for no reason, basically. Like, just recently, Mike got me into staffing. Just spinning the staff, dude. And it's something that, it's just, it's so awesome. But I've honestly found myself thinking, like, so what am I going to do with this? Like, what, like, so I'm practicing it. Like, I'm getting good at it. What is it good for, you know? Because that, and see, that's that selfish mindset that you're talking about, that you have at work. And interestingly enough, like, I got my $10,000 from my car accident a while ago. And I basically quit my job to make music. I wanted to try to make music as my career. But what I realized is that it became, now that you mentioned it, selfish at that point. My music, for me, became selfish because now I was trying to make money off of it. Now it had a point to it. It had like a selfish return, I guess, in some way. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, now that I think about it, that could have a lot to do with why I really didn't have that much motivation to make music while I was on that 5-month break. I had 5 months of no work when I was planning to make a bunch of music, and I'd made a lot of music, but there was a lot of times where I just did not feel like doing it. Like, it just, it wasn't, it didn't have the same careless, playful fun to it, I guess, where it just didn't matter. Like, it had ego intertwined with it now, I guess. It mattered as far as my ability to survive, I guess, my ability to thrive in the world.
Yeah, it's like, kind of, because sometimes I go through these phases where I skateboard a lot, and I just really want to do it, and I'm just really amped, and I'm like, fuck yeah, this is like the best thing in the world right now, like, this is awesome, you know, and I'm just really drawn to do that. Mm-hmm. And there's some points where I'm just like, eh, I don't really want to do it right now, you know? And if I do it at those points where I'm just, like, forcing myself to do it, I don't have that much fun, you know? I'm just like, eh, you know, I'm just not really feeling it, you know? It's just not my day, you know? And I feel like, at least for me, with stuff like artistic stuff like that, like drawing or doing anything, I kind of have to be drawn to do it. I kind of have to feel that pull to want to do it, because it soothes something in me, and it makes me feel better. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I feel like I have to have that passion to do it at the moment, you know.
Yeah.
And that those are just some of the little phases that I go through, you know. I get drawn to different things at certain points that really gain my attention, you know, and I really go into something and then chill for a minute if I kind of lose it, you know, if I lose my hots for it, you know. Yeah.
And I could definitely say for some things, especially with music, that that desire, that like inspiration, it's pretty much a requirement. Like, you're making art, like, you know, for painting, for anything that just is like on the high levels of creativity, even skateboarding at certain levels, you know, a lot of times skateboarding, it's like kind of, it's all automatic, you got it all memorized, but there's a lot of times where it maxes out the level of creativity. It's way up there on creativity.
Mm-hmm.
But that inspiration is a key part of it, and I started to realize that as I was on my little break, because I realized that I'm not going to be able to force myself to make good music. Like, you have to have, like, a message, like how you said. You have to be inspired in some way. And inspiration comes from, I guess now that I think about it, it comes from stepping out of your comfort zone a lot. That's where a lot of inspiration comes from. But also just from day-to-day random things. Like, it can come up from anything. Like, just staring at you know, your girlfriend, the way the light hits her in a specific way, like, or, like, just looking out the window, and it's, like, snowy outside, and you see, like, the way the snow's falling on the tree, and it's, like, hanging on it in a weird way, and the way the whole tree works, it's just, some ways, like, especially nature, now that I get on topic of nature, it's, like, communication of inspiration, like, just in the complexity of it, like, the natural, beautiful complexity that Mother Nature somehow has made, and just infinitely makes, it's mm-hmm. it's very inspiring, just naturally inspiring.
Yeah, most definitely. It's definitely something to, yeah, it's definitely naturally inspiring, but with certain things, I really have to get into them if I want to, like, I can't just dip my toe in, you know, like.
Yeah, that's true. Requires a certain level of mastery before you can even, like, say you've experienced it. Uh-huh. Like, just like snowboarding, for instance, you couldn't say, I'm going to go snowboarding one day and be like, nah, I don't like it anymore. Like,
yeah.
Well, yeah, you're not going to like it. It was your first day. You have, like, to, in order to say that you fully experienced snowboarding, you would have to get to the point where you're actually, I guess, good enough to where you can say that you if you did or didn't like it, you know?
Yeah, and snowboarding, for one thing, something that me and Jerrick have been doing a lot lately, and it brings a lot of mental challenges to your mind, because I don't know, there's just a lot of decisions to be made, there's a lot of things that you wouldn't even think about, like if you're going through the trees just completely flawlessly, just not even expecting, like, what's gonna happen or what could happen, and you're just flying through there, almost in some sort of psychedelic experience, just almost just flowing right through everything, you know, just in that flow state, you know, just
one version of flow, basically.
Yeah, just that flow state. Yeah. Just a lot of mental challenges, you know, to where it's like, can I really do this, you know, just having faith in yourself.
Yeah, and just being able to calculate risk on the fly.
Mm-hmm.
And also just kind of making gut instinct decisions, I guess, which is, I guess, where intuition play into a little bit, which I would say intuition seems heightened during those flow states. Like, your natural intuition, I would say, is heightened. But, you know, just like you come up on a big jump, it looks very appealing. It always looks appealing, especially if you know you got the skill to do it, but you have no clue what's on the other side, you know? And so you have a choice to make, basically. And you may never come, or maybe you probably will eventually come back to your spot, but you might not come back to there that day. You might not remember that that jump even exists. So you have a choice to make of, do I take the risk and just hit the jump, and, you know, go for it, basically, or do I risk not even being able to hit it? And it's I guess it's kind of a game you have to play, because you could very easily hurt yourself, and when you hurt yourself, that affects all aspects of your life.
Yeah.
You know, that affects your ability to work and everything. So there's money on the table, basically, when you're snowboarding. There's something on the line. There's risk to be taken. You could actually, you know, lose money if you got hurt, you know, lower your quality of life if you got hurt. And I think it's that level of risk that basically forces you into these flow states, with snowboarding, because it's basically like your body sees that there's value to be gained and something to be lost. So it knows that that moment is important, so it basically just pays more attention than it normally would, and that's basically what a flow state is. But then also flow states are when it's when your mind is also shut off the most, which is kind of interesting, because we were just talking about how your brain's a filter. So if you turn off the filter, and that's what allows you to be in a flow state, I don't know, I find that very interesting, because it's like, if you're turning off the filter that is your brain, then what's going up? Because obviously something is increasing in your flow states.
Yeah.
Your like your level of consciousness, basically.
Yeah. The prefrontal cortex is the part of your brain that shuts down in those flow states. And that's basically the part of your brain that is for like just your like thinking part of your brain, for your like
problem solving,
and reasoning, logic.
I think
and shit
a
like
lot
that.
To do with your ego,
time,
your sense of self.
Time, sense of time, sense of self. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, there's a lot of things that go into that, but do you ever, like, if you're, let's say you're coming up to, like, a cliff drop, you know, and you're coming up and you're like, all right, I could jump off this and I could land it, but do you ever think, all right, I could jump off this and I could fucking break my back?
All the time, I mean, I'm not a master of my mind that I can keep those negative thoughts down. Those negative thoughts come to me. Like, I mean, unless it depends on a lot of things, because I feel like when there's people around, I'm willing to take more risk. And I guess that's just an ego thing, but I've heard people say the opposite. When there's people around, then they're not willing to take as much risk. But yeah, I would say a lot of times I see the worst possible.
Yeah, and I feel like it's kind of like that with certain situations and just simple things in life as well, too. Like, at least for me, like, I will be going to do something, let's say. And, like, I will be going to, like, all right, let's say I'm going to talk to a girl or something, you know. I'll be like, all right, I'll just picture the worst thing that could happen. Like, she'll, like, tell me to fuck off or some crazy shit, you know. And it's just like, you know, like, even if that does happen, even if the worst thing does happen, I'm still gonna be fine. So I, like, in situations like snowboarding, like, I understand, like, envisioning the worst situation just in case that will happen. But I can also see getting carried away, like, in certain life situations with envisioning like the worst situation. Like, at least for me, sometimes I get carried away with, like, just having so many different situations play out in my head, and watching the worst one play out in my head is just like, oh my god, I don't know if I even want to do that, because that worst one, you know. And that's just something that goes through my head a lot, because it's like, like, fuck, I don't know if I don't take the risk, even if there is no risk. Girl situation, like, I build some risk up in my head, even though there is no risk.
So it's one of those things that just has two sides, I guess. Like, in a situation where your safety might actually be a factor, then envisioning the worst situation could help you in a sense, prevent you from doing something that you shouldn't be doing. But then there's that side where it's like, you're envisioning a scenario that you're perceiving as bad, but it's not actually bad. It's just that you've, like, kind of convinced yourself that it's bad. Like, and I can totally relate with the just rejection of girls. It's like, it's such a dumb thing, because it's like, why? Okay, one girl turns you down, it's like, what, big deal? But for some reason, as men, we perceive that rejection as like a blow to our ego, you know, so much. Gone again, dude. I keep going on it, and then, like, I forget the point that I was trying to explain before.
That the girl's rejecting you is a blow to your ego.
Yeah, I remember that part.
And then, too
much marriage. Yeah,
it's too baked.
Well, I mean, that was a pretty good first podcast.
Yeah, I feel like that was a pretty fucking solid podcast, and that.
It's fun. I mean, it's rocky, but it's.
Yeah, it was rocky, but like.
We got it out. I feel like
it's gotta flow naturally, you know, like.
Yeah.
We couldn't go with some structured thing
especially.
Yeah. It's just gotta come out. It's just gotta go. But I feel like from here on out, it'll get a lot better. So if you want to keep listening, Yeah. Go for it.
If you found this interesting, I mean, it's only going to get better and better. Yeah. I mean, I can't promise that I'm not going to keep forgetting stuff. Because yeah. I've hit my head too many times. And then combined with the marijuana, it's just a catastrophe as far as short-term.
We'll definitely fuck up, but...
But like, this is the first.
Yeah. And we're all growing people just like everybody else, you know? So we're all learning along just with all you guys. So it is what it is.
Yeah. I mean, thanks for listening. I mean, realistically, if any of you guys want to come join in on this, like, hit us up. We'll you can come in on one of the podcasts. We'll do an interview if you got a specific topic you want to talk about. Like, this can be about anything. We can talk about anything.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right, peace out.